I know with the rain, it's a difficult one. And the topic for tonight is not necessarily a large draw, Sherira Gaon. I mean, many people are familiar with his twin brother, Vilna. Thank you. At least I got a little bit of a laugh. Right, Vilna Gaon. No, right. Okay, the joke is satisfied. Thank you. It's not a topic that I know a lot about, but I'm trying to sort of cover a broad swath of chronological periods in this course, so I thought we should definitely look at it, and we'll take a little bit more broad approach than I would normally for this. But let's start. First of all, we're very grateful to have an anonymous donor for this sponsorship, for this lecture. Your presence here, as I really want to emphasize, is sponsorship in itself, but it's really great to be able to help out the shul for, you know, heat and light, and to eventually be able to move into our new facility. So every sponsorship helps. The shul likes to get $200 for a full sponsorship, and that just takes care of promoting these things overall. And we're grateful for all of your efforts in this. I have something very special in Good and Welfare. I'm not going to take very long to do it today, but this is a really significant thing. Many of you have come to appreciate the fine work of Mr. Rodriguez, who is here filming for us. Let's give him a big hand. Okay. Mr. Rodriguez is a graduate school at Florida International University, where he is studying in the Department of Religious Studies, hoping to become a chaplain for the U.S. Armed Forces. He's actually a veteran of the forces, and in fact, he is our first student at Touro College South who attended on the GI Bill. So we're really pleased to have him. He graduated in June, and cap and gown, full convocation, and so on. But it always takes a while to print out the diplomas. So I know it's a little unofficial, but Mr. Rodriguez, would you come up here and accept your diploma, please? Yay. There it is. This is his bachelor's diploma. Here you go, Mr. Rodriguez. Okay, smile for the internet audience there. Okay, very good. Okay, all right, great. Thank you. Well done. Okay, so that was kind of a fun Good and Welfare thing. Let's go directly to our material. Okay, so Sherira Gaon, his years are 906 to 1006. He lived a century. Obviously, the dates are not exactly precise, but it appears he had a very long and productive life. And interestingly enough, the last three decades of his life were by far the most productive. I mean, what he did before he was 70 years old was significant, but nothing like what he did after he was 70. I was looking for pictures to stick up here to illustrate things, so I put in a, this is a shameless self-promotion here. This is a small book I published just before the Siyum HaShas, which will be part of our discussion today, and since we're going to be talking a lot about the Talmud. This is actually, I think this day was the second closest I've ever come to divorce in my entire married career. When I came back upstairs after the photo shoot, and my wife said, "You wore the tuxedo into the ocean?" But, you know, it was like the metaphor of the sea of Talmud. This is not Photoshop. This is actual live photography. But I put on the inside of the book, it says, "No Gemara volumes were harmed during this photo shoot." And also, I made a special thanks to the dry cleaners who not only cleaned the tux perfectly, but what I didn't realize what would happen besides getting wet with salt water is that, you know, my pants are hemmed, and the hems were full of sand by the time I got out of the water. Like, the sand actually got right in there, so they had to unstitch the hems. All right, anyways.
Did you shrink?
I did not shrink, no. At least I didn't notice. So he's born, he's at a very crucial period in Jewish history. Sherira Gaon represents one of the last of the Gaonim. The term Gaon means pride. It's an honorific, it's a great title. It is used today very, very sparingly to refer to great rabbis. One of the most famous, of course, is the Vilna Gaon, or the Gaon of Vilna, the city Vilnius. His first name was actually Sherira, and Gaon was just the title given to him. It comes from the word ga'ava, which means pride, like the pride of the Jewish people, so to speak. That's the sense of the term. And it's usually used in its traditional context to refer to the heads of the Talmudic academies in Babylon, where they had, you know, the pride of place in the Jewish intellectual world from, let's say, about the 7th century through the 9th century, went into some decline, and Sherira Gaon was able to shore up that decline in manner that we will discuss shortly, and really cement it as one of the high points, the high watermarks of Jewish intellectual history. We know more about him. We know comparatively little about many of these figures, but we know a little more about Sherira Gaon because of a famous letter he wrote, the Igeres de Rav Sherira Gaon, the letter of Rav Sherira Gaon, that is basically a short, so a 20-page history of the transmission of Oral Torah from the time of the Mishnah to the time of the Gaonim in the end of the first millennium. It's a crucial historiographic source because it speaks to Jewish self-understanding of the unfolding of the Oral Torah. It's obviously a problematic source because he didn't have at his disposal the same kind of historical tools that modern historians would have, but nevertheless it is sort of the canonical view of exactly how the Talmud was formed. So my goal for today is to say a little bit about the development of the Talmud, and specifically to the period of the Gaonate, speak a little bit more about Sherira Gaon and his biography, and then speak a little bit about his legacy as well. Okay, that's the plan for today. Let's see how it goes. Okay. So, since I was doing a shameless self-promotion with one book, I said, I got to do one more, so I'm throwing, I don't know why I do these things, but this is another book I wrote, and I just republished it a little while ago before Yom Kippur. I like this cover. This is actually my son Alexander, and he went a year and a half ago. This is wintertime. For those of you who are native to Florida, this is actually what they call snow. It has it's white, it's cold, and so on. And my grandparents, his great-grandparents, are buried in a very, very remote cemetery in northern Canada. And we had to hike in about a mile to get to the actual cemetery, and he broke the snow for me so I could go in and follow him. Anyways, totally irrelevant, and I won't do that anymore. Sorry. So, as I mentioned, he wrote this great letter, the letter of Sherira Gaon, which is a really important historical source for our understanding of the Talmud. The letter was in itself a teshuvah. This is a technical term. It means literally answer, but it is an example of a genre of rabbinic literature that is crucially important. And in fact, the Gaonim were the preeminent creators of this genre. Specifically, once the more or less the canon of the Talmud was formed, once there was sort of like an agreement among Jews worldwide that, okay, this is the Talmud, this is our greatest authoritative text of Jewish law, and I hope to speak in a few minutes about what's inside the Talmud, how does it get to that place, it was nowhere near finished. The Oral Torah, so to speak, is constantly unfolding, and there are all kinds of social and technological innovations that require ongoing rabbinical assistance. And so the way that this was dealt with is communities would typically send she'elot, questions, to the great rabbis. They would send it, let's say, to their local rabbi. If their local rabbi was unable to answer it, they would pass it up to a bigger rabbi, and eventually it would get to the yeshivot in Babylon, where they would provide an answer. The answer was called a teshuvah, response, and altogether this becomes known in Latin as the responsa literature, plural of response in Latin, or the she'elot u'tshuvot, question and answer literature. So this is a classic example of it. In this case, the question is not halachic, like it could be something that's very practical. Like, let's say, for example, a woman was married to a man and then his boat sank, and a little 8-year-old child saw the boat sink and they assumed her husband was on it, God forbid. So does she have the party now, or does she wait 30 days before she has a party? That was a joke. Okay. I'm sorry, Elisa. So, no, I mean, and then she gets remarried, and then all of a sudden the guy swims ashore. So what do you do about the whole situation? So you would ask a question. You would send the question to the rabbis. Joseph, I'm glad you're enjoying this. They would send the question to the rabbis. The rabbis would give a response, and that response constitutes a precedent. and is used in the development of later law. And so they will be consulting historical teshuvot that can go back literally. I mean, when we write teshuvot today, rabbis are still writing teshuvot in the 21st century, and they will be relying on teshuvot that were written easily 1,200 years ago. So it's a serious genre of literature. The great Rav Avadya Yosef, who passed away a little while ago, a brilliant, brilliant mind who wrote about this much teshuvot in tiny little print, double column, massive volumes. Phenomenal achievement, and that's written in the 21st century. Questions can be things like, you know, thinking of a Rav Avadya Yosef, you know, is plastic surgery permitted? And under what circumstances are plastic surgeons allowed to operate? Are men and women allowed to have these kinds of things done? Are tattoos permitted? And interestingly enough, he permitted, for example, medical tattoos. He even permitted like cosmetic tattoos, like false eyebrows, tattooed eyebrows, and interesting things like that. You have to see what he writes. But those are examples of teshuvot. So in this case, someone from Kairan in the year 987 writes a letter to the head of the academy in the city of Pumbedita, and he says, you know, I'm not clear, and we've been talking about it here in Kairan, which is in Egypt, we've been talking about it and talking about it, and no one knows exactly how did we get to this point. I mean, we know we have the Torah, first five books of Moshe, and we have a sense of the rest of the Tanakh, you know, who wrote what pieces and what they're about. But how exactly did we get this oral Torah? How does it take its form in the Talmud today? Would you please, Rabbi Gaon, please, or Rabbi Sherira, please explain to us how we got this transmission? So his response of 20-odd pages is a classic in describing not only Jewish history, but Jewish theology, because he provides a model of understanding, you know, exactly how we got to these texts as we have them today. There are two different versions of the text, because obviously it was published and republished, or actually written down and copied and copied and copied. We have two medieval manuscripts that exist today. There's a lot of scholarly debate trying to figure out the discrepancies between the two of them. I think it goes into a greater level of detail than I'm competent to discuss, especially today, when I prepared so little. But let's go into the basics of what that text was. Okay. So no more pictures of book covers. Who was Sherira Gaon? He was one in a long line of Gaonim. His grandfather was one of the Gaonim, one of the heads of the academies, and he traces his own lineage very far back, as recorded in one of the greatest historians of the time, Abraham Ibn Daud. He goes all the way back, really, to the ancient period in his Yichus, so to speak. After Sherira Gaon, in fact, took that position, he would later hand it off to his son Hai Gaon, and so they would continue this dynasty afterwards, and both of them are really very well known for their roles at this time. What's especially important about his Gaonate as opposed to his predecessors is that around this time, at the turn of the millennium, the Jewish world was beginning to fracture in terms of its intellectual centripetal forces. There were centrifugal forces, meaning the center of the Jewish intellectual world was really spreading out. There were increasing activity of Jews in places like North Africa, Morocco, Spain, and even in the Rhineland, where you have a lot of very powerful Jewish minds engaging in Talmudic study and engaging in the codification of Jewish law. And Babylon was sort of in decline. To a large degree, Sherira felt that this was due to the poor performance of his predecessor, his immediate predecessor, who he felt had kind of like let go of the stick when he should have been maintaining the centrality of Babylon. And so feeling the lack of direction from the core of the Jewish population, a lot of the outlying populations were essentially taking matters into their own hand. Spain in particular, I mean, think about the great distance between Babylon and Spain. It's huge. So Spain was sort of setting off on its own. Some great scholars like Shmuel ibn Nagre and others who are writing great Talmudic commentaries, and Sherira felt that no, everything has to come back to center, and everything has to like recognize the greatness of the city of New York. I mean, Pumbedita, right? That's really what he was thinking of. And we'll speak about how he did that shortly. He was also a very prominent student of pre-Zoharic Kabbalah, meaning the esoteric wisdom of Judaism. His writings in this area are cited, but are unfortunately not extant, so we don't know too much about his work in that field, but we know that he had a huge reputation among the medieval scholars for that. Okay. I'm going to go now a little bit further back in history to try to understand what exactly he's addressing. So do I have any specific, not too hard questions that we can start with? Easy questions? Ms. Abramson, no easy questions? Oh, please, an easy question. Good.
Thank you, Liz. It says, obviously, after the second expulsion,
yes.
Exile.
Correct.
So the centrality of Babylon, its height was after the first exile. So what are we to expect that after the second exile, the same centrality would be taking place in Babylonia? Weren't the Jews already now coming from the Roman Empire exiled more to the European areas?
You're actually an excellent question. The answer is basically yes. The Babylon did develop first as the second center after Jerusalem was destroyed, and that was primarily because of latter migration. There were already Jews there after the first exile, so it was a kind of a natural destination for Jews. And you have a buildup of the population during the second, third, fourth centuries to make that really the great center. The centers of North Africa and Spain and of, let's say, with the exception perhaps of Italy, the growth of the Rhineland is really much later. So you're absolutely right. And I actually have that in this lecture, but it's a few slides down the way, and I'm not sure, I don't want to go past all this stuff and come back. So we'll come back to your question. Excellent question. Thank you. It was not too hard. Okay. So here we go. Let's just do a little basic stuff. I apologize if it's too simple, but we're talking now about the Oral Torah. So let's understand what is the Oral Torah in brief. It is essentially a companion text, and I put it in quotation marks because obviously, as an oral document, it would not be written down for some centuries after it was originally, revealed in Jewish traditional Jewish theology. But it is a companion text to the written Torah, the five books of Moses. This is where I'd like to turn the lights out so you can see. This is Charlton Heston as Moshe Rabbeinu. You want to do it once quickly, Ms. Abramson? Thank you. My lovely assistant, Ms. Abramson. It's going to just turn off the lights for a second. You know, I have a great deal of fondness for this particular lecture. That's excellent. Well done. No, not quite. There you go. Excellent. Look at that. Oh, brilliant. Doesn't she? Right? Okay, that's great. We can turn on lights now. But I will tell you that, I grew up just because I feel like it's very therapeutic for me to share these things with you. I grew up as the only Jewish child in this very small, remote town in northern Canada. And I knew there were Jews in the world. I saw them on Pesach. We went down to Toronto and I saw my cousins. I knew there were a lot of Jews in the world. But, in this little town, there was only like the Anglophones and the Quebecois, and that was me. I felt lonely, like there was the Chinese kid who was my best friend and rival, and that was it. But then they had a theater back then, the Sinequa, and they brought in Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments. I was about 8 years old when I showed there, and I was, this movie is about me. This movie is about my people. I just could not believe it. And it's like a 3-hour movie, and I just sat there as an 8-year-old, completely overwhelmed with it. And even to this day, that one scene where it's completely made up, but it's a cool scene, where the old man who's like preparing the mortar for the bricks and he gets whipped and he's going to die, and Charlton Heston bends down and says to him, how do you feel about the NRA? No, he says, how do you feel? He says to him, what's the matter, old man? And the old man started crying and said, I believe that, I just prayed that one day before I died, my eyes would behold the Redeemer. And of course, he's looking at Charlton Heston right there. Oh my gosh, I get teared up even now. Such a powerful movie. It changed my life. Anyways, there is. The Oral Torah is the companion text to the written Torah, the five books of Moses. And it can be understood as three distinct, slightly interrelated bodies of information. The first is Midrash. Midrash is translated appropriately into the Greek term exegesis, which means, look at this, I'm tearing up thinking about that scene. The exegesis, which means basically deriving meaning from the biblical text. Looking at the written Torah, that you'll find, you know, hundreds of grammatical infelicities, even spelling mistakes, weird conventions like letters printed upside down, letters broken in half, verb subject discontinuities, all kinds of strange things if you just read the text. Now, you know, if you're a copy editor, you'd be tempted to fix things, you know, virtually every third or fourth paragraph. So Midrash, among other things, analyzes all of those slight inconsistencies in the text and derives profound and very beautiful meaning from them. It's almost in a very poetic fashion. Midrash takes the text and develops a lot, much larger depth of functionality to what the text is really saying. And it has become so well ingrained in the Jewish tradition that many children, for example, especially if they're not really, really paying attention in school, they grow up, and when they finally come to read the Torah properly and they say, hey, where's all this other stuff that I learned in school? It's just ingrained right into our understanding of the text. It's impossible for Jews to really understand Torah without Midrash, even though they are really totally separate documents. One of the reasons why Rashi is such a classic commentator is because he is a genius at bringing in selected Midrashim to his commentary on the text. And with Rashi, you get a good anthology of the Oral Torah, the Midrash, on the text itself. Midrash comes in two distinct flavors, so-called halachic Midrash, which essentially derives laws of behavior, of function from the text, or Agadic Midrash, which is much better known, which derives, you know, extra stories, extra plot line, extra dialogue that may not be entirely present in the text. To a certain degree, it is open-ended because, you know, as the Talmud says, the Torah has 70 faces, but there are limits to it. There is a canonical body of texts called Midrash today. They were not published until well into the Middle Ages, really. But you can't just, like, in traditional theology, you can't create a Midrash. That's very popular among non-Orthodox congregations to write Midrash, but that's not at all considered an appropriate way to handle a text from traditional background. Like, for example, here, also from the Ten Commandments, right? That's Ann Baxter and Yul Brynner in the performance of his life as Pharaoh, right? And the whole bit about Ann Baxter actually attracted to Charlton Heston. That was like, to use a Latin term, bubamisis, right? We don't have anything like that in the Midrash, but that's kind of like the direction that Midrash can be taken to its absurdity. The Midrash that we have today is absolutely brilliant, fascinating, puzzling, and really adds tremendous depth to the text. So that's part of Oral Torah handed down from Moshe to his students to the present day as traditional theology would have it. The second element of Oral Torah is the esoteric or mystical wisdom that is known as Kabbalah. This is a much more controversial body of information, largely because the central text of the Kabbalah, one of the most important texts, there are several, is the Zohar, which doesn't appear on the Jewish scene publicly until the 13th century. And traditionalists argue that, in fact, it was authored by Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai already in the ancient period and kept hidden until the 13th century. Many modern critics already in the Age of Enlightenment were saying, no, it was actually written in the 13th century. Not our place here to engage in that debate. But there's no question that there are lots of other texts which are much early that follow in this vein. The magical aspects of Torah, the mystical, no, it's a word when you try, it's a really fancy word, when you try to do things with Kabbalah. Oh, it's
practical Kabbalah,
but there's a really good fancy word for it. Yeah, there's a really good word that's like, it'll come to me in the shower later, I'll think of it. But there's a really good word that would impress you and you would say, wow, so we're learning at a really high level. Did you hear the word that he said? That was great. I could just make one up. But anyways, theurgic, that's it, theurgic Kabbalah. Isn't that a great word? Can I have a hand for that word, theurgic, right? Theurgic Kabbalah is just a fancy way of saying practical Kabbalah, meaning if we want to create a golem, for example, an artificial anthropoid, if we wanted to make like a robot out of clay, or if we wanted to demand Mashiach, we wanted to make it rain, make it stop raining, things like that. So there's that practical Kabbalah side. There's also a theoretical Kabbalah, which doesn't speak about actually forcing changes onto the universe, but it speaks about what is the nature of the soul, what is the nature of God, how does God interact with the world, things like that. It's also very, very deep, profound wisdom. And that's also in the Oral Torah, it's only hinted at in places in the written Torah. And then you have the third part, which is going to occupy our attention for the rest of the day, law. How should Jews behave? Midrash speaks to how Jews should think. The Kabbalah thinks about how Jews should dream or imagine, and law talks about how Jews should behave, the Mishnah. Mishnah is a very important ancient document that records the oral teachings on exactly how to interpret the Torah, and they're absolutely essential. They perform several distinct functions. For example, the Mishnah clarifies ambiguities in the text. On the holiday of Sukkot, I hope I'm not repeating myself from an earlier lecture, I probably am. But on the holiday of Sukkot, for example, it says that you're supposed to go to shul and you're supposed to bring with you four plant species, a lulav, a myrtle, a willow, and a pre-Eitz Hadar, which means basically the fruit of a nice tree. So if you bring, you know, on Sukkot, as you come to shul, you bring your lulav and a grapefruit, you could say the grapefruit is a fruit of a nice tree. Taka, it's very nice, smell it, it's nice color and so on, but you will be laughed out of the shul because there is a tradition that says the pre-Eitz Hadar, the fruit of a nice tree, refers specifically and only to the $95 lemon that you can buy only this one time a year, the Esrog, and nothing else counts. So the Mishnah will clarify those kinds of ambiguities. The Mishnah will also fulfill omissions in the text. For example, we have absolutely nothing written in the Torah about what tefillin should look like. You know, what do you do with tefillin? It's actually Mishnah and even further development of our law, but it says only that it should be a sign upon your arms and as frontlets between your eyes. So who would say that that automatically turns into a black box made of leather with parchment inside it and straps coming down? You know, that's like all oral Torah, it's not written Torah. And finally, on occasion, the Mishnah and later Talmud is it contradicts the written Torah. On a very small number of occasions, the oral Torah will actually say, we don't do it like it says there. Like, for example, it says you will give him 40 lashes for his crime, and the oral Torah says it really means 39. Or the Torah says an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and the Mishnah says, no, it means the monetary value of an eye in payment for an eye, that kind of thing. So that's a very important function that the Mishnah has. These three things together I wanted to go really back over here to show the overall slide. Can we do that nicely? Sure we can. These three things together form the oral Torah as we have it today. Okay, any arguments or discussions, challenges, objections? Wow, clear as the sun at noonday. I wish my children were like so attentive and, you know, compliant. Right, Elisa? Okay. Now, the reason why we have a transition from the oral to the written Torah is really due to the massive crisis of the second century. Just a very quick history recap. This is an artistic rendition of the destruction of the temple. The Jews, we talked about this in previous lectures, the Jews had a failed rebellion in the year 66, went on for 6 years, and ultimately was completely unsuccessful, ended in the last stand at Masada. The Jews suffered under tremendous persecution for the next few decades, and in the year 135, there's another attempt to throw the Romans out of Israel under Bar Kokhba, also unsuccessful, followed by horrific persecutions under the Emperor Hadrian. So by the time you get to the middle of the second century, the Jewish world is really suffering. There's a complete lack of a centralist leadership. There is a huge demographic impact when, you know, a generation and then their grandchildren are completely devastated in futile rebellions against Rome, especially the male population. There's been a large-scale exile from Israel, primarily to Babylon at this point. And the Jewish community has lost, perhaps most importantly, it has lost the central locus of its worship. Everything was centered on the temple. Everything was centered on the idea of bringing your sacrifices there. I mean, how many generations can you go losing that central unifying factor and still continue as a people? So a rabbi named Yehuda Hanasi, and this is now going to the text of Rav Sherira Gaon's famous letter, a rav named Yehuda Hanasi realized the difficulty of the situation, and he resolved to write down the Oral Torah and to create essentially a portable Judaism that would allow Judaism to actually be taken on the road, and it could survive and amazingly even flourish without the temple. And this magnificent work of literature was the Mishnah, as we shall see. Yes, Ms. Abramson.
How was he able to write down the Oral Torah? Isn't the whole fact that it is an Oral Torah, I mean, that it's supposed to stay in the Oral Torah, and that you need it so to carry it on?
That is a brilliant question. I'm so glad you asked that. The rabbis and the Talmud, they argued back and forth, how could he do this? You know, I mean, if God gave it to us in an oral format, how dare you? What audacity to transform it to a written format? And if we look at it beyond like the technicalities of, okay, what's the big deal, written, spoken, what's the difference? It's a huge difference. The very quality of orality is huge because there's a level of information that is conveyed through oral teaching that is completely flattened by textual presentation. That's one of the reasons, by the way, that I like taping these and delivering them on the internet, because, you know, you can read everything I'm saying in a book, and you can read it even better and more accurately, maybe without the jokes and stuff like that, but all the information is there. The learning is not necessarily there. The features of an oral presentation, even one that's fairly, where I do most of the talking and you do most of the listening, unlike a partnership of chevrusas, is that, you know, you see my tonality, you see my facial expressions, my body language, you see where I emphasize, what I don't emphasize. You know, there's a whole message that is delivered here that cannot be retained on the written page. So the rabbis were saying, there is no way that we can do this. It will completely destroy it. It's like making everything, you know, into black and white. Only how much more so? Nevertheless, Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi justified it, as the Talmud would later say, through the verse in Tehillim that says, "Eis lasos l'Hashem heferu Torah secha." It is time to act for God. They have destroyed your Torah. Meaning, we're at a place where we must, you know, take a bold step, and we must act for God because they, in this sense, the Romans, have destroyed your Torah. They've destroyed the temple. They've destroyed our national integrity. What are we going to do? Others, by the way, criticized him with the same verse, saying, oh, you say it's a time to act for God? You've destroyed the Torah. Meaning you're going to do this, that in itself destroys the Torah. But part of his genius was that, and I don't want to go into this in great detail here, but the Mishnah itself has a tremendous degree of ambiguity built right into it. Like, for example, a typical Mishnah will take an issue, let's say whether or not a particular kind of chicken with a particular kind of defect is kosher or not, and the Mishnah will say, Rabbi X says this chicken is kosher, and then Rabbi Y says this chicken is not kosher. And then you go on to the next Mishnah. And if you're reading this like a law code, you want to say, well, no, what am I having for dinner tonight? Can I eat this chicken or not? The Mishnah does not say. The Mishnah leaves it open-ended, so you must perforce have a teacher. It preserves the Masorah. You must have someone who will explain the Mishnah to you, say that even though we quote Rabbi X, because Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi constantly quoted minority opinions, we nevertheless follow the opinion of Rabbi Y, and these are the reasons, and that's essentially what keeps the oral nature of the Mishnah intact, even though it is actually based in a written text. Otherwise, it would be like reading the newspaper. It in itself has those ambiguities that begs debate and demands attention. Good question. Very good. I hope the answer was good enough. Okay, so he says, let's write down the Mishnah, and then the Mishnah ends up looking like this. There are Six orders, just to run through them to give you a sense of what they're talking about. The first is called seeds, or zeraim, and it deals almost exclusively with agricultural law. A lot of laws in the Torah that deal with the sabbatical year, mixing species, all kinds of things like that. It also deals with laws of blessings because, after all, you know, we are sustained by the natural world around us, and blessings therefore fit in that section. Then the next section are times, moed, that deals with the Shabbat, Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and so on, all the various holidays. The third section and largest section is called women. It's also the most mysterious and difficult to understand. I'm just making that up. But the reason why, I'll ask you, Ms. Abramson, why is there a section on women and there's not a section on men? How come there's a whole section, one of the six sections on women, no section on men?
They're complicated.
I'm sorry?
They're very complicated.
Okay, right. We have a little section maybe. Now the answer is because the Mishnah is basically a very androcentric document. It's something that is written by men, for men to consume. Even the concept of women studying the Mishnah the way men study the Mishnah was pretty foreign to most of the ancient world. There were always exceptional women who did master the Mishnah throughout history, but it was a very, very unusual circumstance. We happen to live, ironically, in a time of, it's like Charles Dickens, right? We live in the best of times and the worst of times. On the one hand, we have the most atrocious level of Jewish ignorance ever in our history, especially in this country. But at the same time, we have some of the highest levels of education available for women in our times, you know, after the Beis Yaakov movement and so on, even studying Talmud for women. So we live in a weird time. But your grandparents, your great-grandparents for sure, wouldn't know how to list even these six sections. But Nashim, women, is the largest section, it's the largest section of the Talmud, not the largest of the Mishnah, but it's basically men trying to understand their relationship with women. So a lot of discussion of marriage, of divorce, of levirate marriage, you know, like when someone, God forbid, dies childless and his wife then marries his brother, that kind of thing. Right after women, as the yeshiva joke goes, then you study damages. Okay, thank you for chuckling. It was a joke, right? Damages is perhaps the most classically studied part of the Talmud, and that deals with, you know, the Reuven's goat ate the prized tomatoes of Shimon, but then tripped on his porch and broke his leg. So how much does Reuven have to pay Shimon for the tomatoes, and Shimon has to pay for the broken leg, and was the fence allowed the goat in? All these kinds of basically tort law, criminal law, that's dealt with in damages. The last two sections are dealt with, deal primarily with the Talmudic, with the temple period, holy things, which deal with sacrificial law, and purities that deal with ritual purity for the purposes largely of temple worship. Those two sections are studied less than the others. Now, what's interesting about the Mishnah, among many things, is that Rabbi Yehuda Nasi, he didn't write it, he compiled it. He collected sayings from teachings from all the rabbis of his generation, writing them all down, and then he sifted through them, and he tried to determine, okay, which teachings are the best, which teachings are the most accurate, the most comprehensive, the most concise, and so on, and those he boiled down into the Mishnah. However, all those other teachings that either were inaccurate, or were fragmentary, or were misleading, he did not throw them away, because Judaism is inherently conservative. We don't like to throw too many things away. That's what my wife says about my desk drawer, that I, you know, hang on to things too long. So those extra bits of text were preserved in two distinct documents, the so-called baraitot, which is an Aramaic phrase meaning outside. These are bits of Mishnaic teachings that didn't make the cut for the Mishnah itself, and also the Tosefta, or the additional texts. These are also teachings floating around in the time of the Mishnah, did not quite make into the Mishnah, but we didn't throw them away. If you get a volume of the Talmud today, you'll see that the Tosefta is actually printed at the back of the Talmud in its entirety of every tractate, but they're mixed into the Talmudic text itself. If you look at this diagram here, so the Talmud is made up of the following. It's made up of the Mishnah. It's a discussion of the Mishnah and the use of Tosefta and baraitot to clarify the meaning of the Mishnah, when all these things are mixed together with a whole bunch of miscellany texts dealing with biographical stories, legends, recipes, folk stories, you know, cures for diarrhea and all kinds of amazing things all buried into this document as a kind of a glue, then you have the Talmud. Ta-da! Right? I actually like that. Can I show you that again? Mm-hmm. Let's do it again because the graphics are really fun. So you start out with the Mishnah, and then the rabbis, the Mishnah, by the way, is set to writing sometime around the year 200. So it's set to writing sometime around the year 200, and a lot of discussion is going on about it. And so those discussions are that are recorded, and they are made up primarily of passages from the Tosefta and the Baraitot, challenging understandings of the Mishnah, debates around the Mishnah, and a lot of other miscellaneous stuff that takes up, I don't know, off the top of my head, maybe 25% of the Talmud is in the miscellaneous category. That altogether is what we know as the Talmud today. And this is basically Rav Sherira Gaon's description of how we got to where we are today, intellectually, through the passage of the writing of the Mishnah, the additions to the Braitot, the Tosefta, miscellany, and that, then we get to this central document, which was basically set to the writing we have today sometime around the end of the 5th century. There's a certain amount of debate. We could go even a century either way. There were two versions of it, one that was brought together in northern Israel. It's called the Jerusalem Talmud, slight misnomer because it wasn't in Jerusalem, but nevertheless also called the Palestinian Talmud, and the more authoritative later recension of the Babylonians that is the one more widely studied and is pictured here today. Okay, so this, why Babylon? This is getting to your question now. Here's a quick look at what happened to the Jews and why Babylon became the main center of the Jewish people during the centuries after the destruction of the Second Temple. Israel, of course, located here, and there was an exile in the 6th century BCE. So we're talking now about 600 years earlier. It was not a very deep exile, didn't reach deep into the demographic pool of the Jewish people, tended to exile primarily the leadership, but they were sent all the way out here to the Mesopotamian region. So-called Mesopotamus because it's from the between the rivers, Potamos's rivers in Greek, the two very important rivers of the Euphrates and Tigris rivers that here take a lot of the silt from the mountainous regions here, and the rivers flow downward into the Persian Gulf, bringing regular flows of nitrogen-rich soil that once the Babylonians, already in the Assyrian period, learned how to create dams to control the flooding, this became like Silicon Valley of the ancient world, because they had all of this new soil coming down every year. It was amazing for agriculture, and it created a replenishable, renewable resource that was a tremendous economic engine. So this is really a very, very wealthy area historically. This is where Abraham came from originally, and he wandered all the way over here to the only country in the Middle East without any natural reserves of oil. And then eventually the Jews went, that was a joke, no one caught it, right? I was doing, thank you, Estebel. Appreciate it. So the Jews, during the first expulsion, made their way over here. And there was not a long expulsion. It was less than a century that the Jews were forced to live there. And again, most Jews didn't even leave. Most Jews were still in Israel at that time. The leadership was over there. And then under Cyrus, they were allowed to return. Only a small minority returned to Israel. Most of them were very comfortable, thank you very much, in Babylon and decided to stay. So that means you have a strong diaspora community that had been in existence for 600 years by the time you get to the destruction of the Second Temple. Again, if we think of our historical scope, right here, Jews have been in America for a little more than 300 years. And, you know, the idea of how cemented Jews are to this country, if you can imagine that our exile was twice that length, 600 years in Babylon, and it's a very, very ancient community. So it stands to reason that when the Jews were exiled the second time in the first century, it was a natural destination. They knew that here in the lower Tigris-Euphrates River Valley, there are going to be Jewish establishments, Jewish settlements. And so gradually, Jews made their way over there. There was also a movement along the coast of North Africa, across the Mediterranean to Italy itself, and eventually up into Spain. You already have Jewish populations in Spain by the 5th and 6th century. But the largest center was certainly in the well-established region of Babylon. Throughout the Talmudic period, and by that I mean the period between the Mishnah and, let's say, the closing of the Talmud, let's say at the outside about the year 600, there's a lot of description of Jews moving back and forth between these regions and a certain amount of friendly rivalry between them, but there's no question that the Mesopotamian River Valley was like the New York of those days. It was the major center of the Jewish people, if demographically, intellectually, economically, if not necessarily spiritually. Okay, let's go on a little further. What can we say about these Jews in Babylon? As I mentioned, there's like kind of like an ongoing rivalry between them. When you read the Talmud, they speak about when he came over here, meaning like when there was a rabbi from Israel who came to Babylon, or vice versa. The Jerusalem Talmud talk about when they came by us, you know. So, and they always have like slight disdain for each other, depending on the context. But at the same time, a huge symbiosis. The fact that there is, you know, a traffic of scholars moving back and forth indicates that there's sufficient communities in both places. And I mentioned how they both wrote Talmuds, but the Jerusalem Talmud ultimately was eclipsed by the later Babylonian Talmud for many reasons. One of the most important is that the Babylonian Talmud was written later, so it was able to consult the opinions of the Jerusalem Talmud. Another is because the Jews of Israel found themselves under very different kind of leadership from the outside world, the Roman Empire, than they had in Babylon. And in some degree, the Babylonians had it much easier. They did not have, for example, the Christian interference with Jewish rituals and activities. The Jews in Babylon lived in various periods under the Sasanians, for example, and the influence of the Zoroastrian faith, which is seen in the Talmud occasionally, how Jews have to deal with it, but it was minor compared to what the Jews had to deal with in Israel. They also had a much stronger political system. They had an institution called the Exilarch, or the Resh Galuta, the head of the exile, which was occupied by someone who was descended from the line of David, the Davidic dynasty. And so they had a significant amount of self-rule, self-government in Babylon that they did not enjoy in Israel. Up until the 5th century, that's when they really established their primacy with the creation of the Talmud, one of the greatest literary achievements of the Jews ever. And they maintained that for another 500 years, but it was going to a steep decline by the time you get to Sherira Gaon, which takes us back to our main topic. Yes? No, please, go ahead.
Thank you. I understood what you were explaining. In the middle of the 2nd century, the Mishnah was written, because it was an emergency, and mm-hmm. the Mishnah was written through the compilation of what was considered by Rabbi Yehuda Hatzitz, and then there were the Tosfos and the Baraitos, etc. But then sort of like it happens that the Talmud was written. What do you mean written? It was already written. What does it mean that the Talmud was written? I'm not sure.
That's an excellent question. I'm glad you asked, because I could feel myself as I was saying it, I was kind of rushing through it. Basically, it's like this. The Mishnah itself, it's hard to understand, right? It doesn't have clear direction in a lot of places. So rabbis would get together and they would argue about the Mishnah and argue and argue and argue. And these arguments, when they were really geschmack arguments, really good arguments, they would kind of remember the key points of the arguments. And somehow over the course of centuries, these arguments were boiled down to the code words or just little codified phrases. And then he said this, and you have to remember really what that all meant. And that was eventually all these like memorized debates were then set to writing. And that set to writing debates is the Talmud.
Can I ask by whom?
So good question. So it involves hundreds of rabbis, right? They're like over the period of several centuries, there are lots of voices in the Talmud, hundreds of voices. And there's some debate as to exactly which rabbis were the people who closed the Talmud. The traditional view is Ravina and Rav Ashi, but there's a lot of debate over were they given that that credit, and it really happened later, or it really happened earlier. But basically, the story, as given by Rav Sherira Gaon, is, yeah, they would memorize these debates, and then they finally said, let's set them down to writing, and that's the canonical text we have known as the Talmud. It's a long, extended debate on the meaning of the Mishnah, with lots of citations from the outside sources to try to bolster a point of view. But it most importantly, it reminds me of a joke. So I'll tell you this joke very quickly. So I mentioned how the arguments were codified, right? People are like rolling their eyes, but it's almost over. I have to say these jokes. Otherwise, I just go home and I feel very frustrated. So the joke goes like this. There are people in a prison who are living together for a long time, right? Of course, they're incarcerated. And they don't see other people. Until one day a new prisoner is put into the jail. And he sits down in the mess hall with them and they're sitting and eating. And then one of the prisoners says, 52. The other prisoners all break out laughing. And then another prisoner says, 37. And then they all fall on the floor laughing. And this goes on for a while till the new prisoner says, what's going on? And they say, well, you see, the thing is, we've been in prison together for so many years. We all know each other's jokes so well that we just gave each joke numbers. And whenever we want to tell a joke, we just say the number and we remember the joke and we laugh, right? That's what we do. So he says, wow, that's great. Can I try it? And they say, sure, go ahead. So he's looking around at all the other prisoners at the table and he says to them, 16, stone-faced. He says, 22, no reaction. Finally, the guy leans over and says, listen, he says, you're telling them all wrong. All right. Okay, so that's essentially like the Talmud is written, is all these really tightly coded phrases where if you just read it without the oral tradition, without a Masorah, without a rabbi, you would say, what could this possibly mean? Compounding this fact is the truism that the Talmud has no punctuation. So you don't even know with reliability when one phrase ends and the next one begins. It really takes a tremendous amount of highly specialized study, years of practice to be able to decode even a single page of the Talmud. Once you get it, once you can really do, let's say, I don't know off the top of my head, if you can learn 50 pages on your own, then you're pretty much well set to do the entire Talmud. But just learning those 50 pages may take you 5-6 years to learn how to do it. It's a very difficult process. Anyways, Sherira Gaon. So he was a Gaon in one of the prime cities of Babylon, the city of Pumbedita. There are about half a dozen cities that were especially important. Pumbedita was one of the two most important. The other was Sura, certain amount of rivalry between those two cities. He got into a certain amount of trouble because he was the chief judge of the rabbinical court, and he did not agree that they should appoint Nehemiah to be the Gaon before him, and he refused to consent to the appointment of one Nehemiah. We don't know too much about the reasons for it, but based on his later activity, it appears that Nehemiah was perhaps responsible for not taking control of the situation and centralizing rule in Babylon in respect for Babylonian scholarship. So that got him into quite a bit of hot water in the year 960, but 8 years later, when Sherira was already a man of 70, Nehemiah passed away, and so the mantle of leadership fell onto Sherira Gaon at this time. And then he devoted the next three decades of his life, he lived an entire century, he devoted the next three decades of his life to specifically shoring up the reputation of Babylon, reaching out to far-flung communities throughout the Mediterranean basin, and making sure that they directed their questions to the yeshiva, the academy, in Pumbedita. And it appears that many of the communities throughout the world felt that they were really lacking this leadership. They needed someone to stand up and say, yes, we have the answers. You can just send them to us and we will respond. And we will respond with sensitivity and understanding for your local conditions. And so there was a huge surge of response and popularity under his rule. He also took the distant leaders to task, saying that, you know, why are you Why are you disdaining this place where we've built up so many hundreds of years of education? Why are you simply ignoring us? You should definitely show your allegiance intellectually to Babylon. And it made a tremendous difference for at least another century. His literary achievements are similarly long-lasting. We've spent the better part of the hour talking about the so-called Igeret, or letter, which is just one of his teshuvot. And in fact, together with his son Haigaon, who also was an extremely powerful leader, they authored about half of the all of the teshuvot that exist in the Gaonic period, which means for about 400 years, half of all of these responses come from either Sherira or his son Haigaon. A tremendous number of responses. If you can imagine, he's sitting at his desk getting these letters every day, writing out by hand his detailed analytical comments based on his knowledge of the Talmud, sending them out. It was an incredibly important. It was like, well, I won't give a trite answer. We know that he wrote a biblical commentary. It is no longer extant, but it is referred to by other writers from the period. And we know we have some pieces of a massive Talmudic commentary that unfortunately has not survived as well. And finally, he wrote a book called the Megillat Sitarim, which appears to be a commentary on the non-legal aspects of the Talmud. Unfortunately, that text is lost. The most famous of his texts is this Igeret, where we learn almost everything we know about Sherira Gaon and some of his contemporaries. In his life, however, despite the tremendous burdens he took upon himself, it would not be tranquil. In the year 998, some of his rivals, perhaps, we don't know the nature of the controversy, it's not recorded in the historical accounts of that time, but apparently some of his rivals denounced him to the caliph. And you get a sense of the tenuous situation of the Jewish leadership, because ultimately we were a minority within a country, and even though we would have significant self-rule and self-government, still we had to answer to the secular authorities. And so the caliph of the time arrested Sherira and his son, who was then the head of the court, and imprisoned him for almost a full year. He was eventually released, apparently acquitted of all charges, but by that point, again, remember, he's a very elderly man at this point, his health was ruined, and he appointed his new son, Haigaon, who was also an elderly man at this point as well. He's already in his 70s, if I'm not mistaken. So he stepped down from his position in favor of his son at that time. So to speak to his legacy, we can evaluate it in many different ways. One way to be sure is that he really consolidated for a millennium the centrality of the Talmud, explaining directly how it flowed from the Mishnah. He upheld the value of the Mishnah as a central text in the Pharisaic tradition that we have today as the rabbinic tradition. And the study of the Talmud was, you know, enshrined as the central activity of Jews intellectually for the next 1,000 years. As you can see in this picture here, which is from the last Siyum HaShas, which was a year ago, August, if I'm not mistaken, where they had 70,000 Jews in the MetLife auditorium alone celebrating the completion of the Talmud, which is something that is unprecedented since Babylonian times, perhaps even before Babylonian times. It's rather an amazing thing. And there were no fistfights or anything in the entire. Okay, thank you, Mr. Rodriguez. Secondly, his activity in the composition of Teshuva literature was extremely important in creating a body of legal documentation that became a corpus for future law. And his general adherence to the notion of the validity of the Oral Torah and the binding nature it had upon Jews was something that, you know, reverberated throughout the centuries following his demise. So as always, I thank you for your patience and your indulgence. Thank you for your attention. Next week, we're going to stay in the Gaonate, and we're going to look at Saadia Gaon, also an extremely important leader of one of the academies, an extremely important philosophical leader as well. So we'll look at some of his specific ideas. But the big difference will be, under Saadia, we'll talk a lot more about the influence of Islam on Judaism and vice versa. Thank you very much for your attention. Thanks.